Hey guys, in one of my previous videos, we took an existing Streamlit app and added a logging form. So only when the user provides the correct credentials, they can access the web app. We did this with the help of the Streamlit Authenticator package. In particular, we converted plain text passwords into hashed ones. We then took the hash passwords and stored them in a pickle file. In the actual Streamlit app, we loaded the pickle file and used it for the user authentication. I received many comments that storing the credentials in an actual database would be even better. And this is exactly what we are going to do in this video. We will start from where we left off in the old video. So if you haven't seen it yet, I recommend watching that video first. I will leave the link to the video in the info card above. Okay, and with that said, let us get started. As a first step, let us set up the database. I have decided to use a service from DataCloud. Mainly because it is super easy to set up, it is free, and I also use it for some of my hobby projects. To get started, navigate to data.sh. On this page, click on the Join Data button. The signup procedure is very straightforward. Just enter your username, password, and email. Once done, you will get a confirmation email with your activation link. After your account has been activated, you can sign in. You might get this welcome message if you log in for the first time. For now, you can close it. We will come back to our project key in just a moment. Data offers three services: a cloud environment, a database, and file storage. For this tutorial, we are only interested in the database. Therefore, navigate to Base and click on Python. Here you will find the steps to get started. As a first step, we are going to install the Data SDK. To do so, open up your terminal or command prompt, type pip install data and hit enter. I already installed it. As a next step, let us get our project key. You can create a new key under your settings by clicking create key. As mentioned here, the key will be only shown once and you should store it in a safe place. Additionally, you do not want to expose the key because anybody with this key would have access to your database. With that in mind, let me copy the key to my clipboard. For the next step, I will create a new Python file. I will call this Python script database.py. In the file, I will import data from data. After that, I will store our key in a variable. Later in the video, we will save the key in an environment variable, but for now, we will keep things simple here. With our key, we can initialize a data object. With that object, we can now create or connect to a database. All we need to do is to provide a name for the database. I will call mine users_db. Okay, and with that in place, we are ready to use our database. There is no need to predefine any table columns with the respective type. Data will do it automatically for us. I will define a function to insert a new entry into our database. This function should take the username, name, and password as parameters. And it couldn't be easier. All you need to do is to use put on the database object variable, followed by the values you want to insert. You want to provide the values in a dictionary. There's only one thing I want to highlight. For the primary key, I'm using the username. So the username will be the unique identifier. There shouldn't be multiple users with the same username. With our function in place, let me test it out. Like in the first video, I will create a user for Peter Parker. The username will be pparker and the password is abc123. Okay, if I now run the script and do not get any errors, I successfully inserted the user. We could also validate this in our data dashboard. After refreshing the page, you should see the user's database on the left side. One of the features I really like about data is that it already comes with a simple graphical user interface to manipulate the database. If you wanted to, you could also insert entries directly from this interface. So let me add another user to our database and delete Peter Parker. Back in the script, let us now fetch all users from our database. Also, this is super easy. You just need to type db.fetch. This will return an instance of a FetchResponse class. This class has different properties. In our case, I want to return the items. And that is all there is to it. So let me test it out by printing out all users. It is a little bit hard to read, but here in my text editor, I can see that we have only Rebecca Miller in our database. And those two functions are all we need for our user authentication. However, just as a bonus, let me also show you some other useful queries, like getting back all the details from a particular user. If I run this query with our user rmiller, we will get back all the fields in a Python dictionary. Another useful function would be to update any user. For this, we need two things: the user we want to update and the fields we want to change. You can specify the fields in a Python dictionary. So, as an example, for the username rmiller, I want to change the name to Rebecca Parker. After executing the script, we can validate this update in our dashboard. After a quick refresh, we can now see the updated name. And last but not least, you might want to delete a user. This is also very easy. You just need to type db.delete followed by the username. And as before, let me also test it out by deleting rmiller. After running the script, we should see that our database is empty again. Okay, now that everything is working, let us take care of our project key. As mentioned, we do not want to keep it hard-coded in our Python file. A better idea is to save it as an environment variable. To do so, I will use a helper library which you can install via pip. The package is called python.env. I already have it installed on my machine. So back in my script, I will import OS, a core Python module, and I will import load.env from .env. Now I can load the environment variable by using load_.env followed by the file name. So let us now create this .env file in the same directory. Therefore, I will copy our key, create a new text file, and name it .env. In this file, I will define a name as data key with our actual key. Okay, after saving the file, I can switch back to the Python script. Instead of our hard-coded key, I can now use os.getenv and the name was data key. Now that we have our .env file, you want to avoid uploading it to GitHub or any other platform. Therefore, also ensure to create a gitignore file. I usually use a service from gitignore.io. Just head over to their website, type Python and click on create. Then copy the whole text, go back to your project folder, create a new text file and name it .gitignore. In this text file, paste the text you just copied. If you scroll up a bit, you will see that Git will ignore any kinds of environment files. You might also want to add any other files that you do not want to upload to your online Git repository. For example, I will add a small helper file called uploadtodatabase.py. We will use this file to insert some values into our database. So let me quickly create this Python script. In this file, we will need the Streamlit Authenticator package and our local database file. Then I will define the usernames, names and passwords. As in the previous video, I will convert the plain text password to hashed ones. With those list defined, I will insert each user into our database. To do that, I will loop over all the three lists simultaneously using the zip function. I will insert a record with the username, name and hash passwords within each iteration. To check if it's working, I will execute the script and head over to my data dashboard. After a quick refresh, we will see our entries. Okay, as this is all working now, I can delete the files from the previous video, so the generate.py and the pickle file. Instead, we will get the users directly from the database. So here in my Streamlit app, I can remove the pairflip and pickle import, as we will only need our local database.py file. In particular, we now want to retrieve the names, usernames and passwords. So let me delete the following lines and fetch all the users from our database. we will return the users in a dictionary, which will look like this. To pass it to our authentication object, I will convert the values to a list using a list comprehension. So for each user in users, I will store the different keys in a separate list. And that is all there is to it. The rest of the code remains the same. Now I can test it out by switching back to my app. After a quick refresh, I will try to log in with the username pparker. Okay, this seems to be working. Yet if I go back to my data dashboard and delete Peter Parker from my table, we should get an error message in Streamlit. So let me try to log in again. As expected, we will get the following message. Likewise, we could also change any values in our database, like changing the name to Rebecca Parker. The username and password will remain the same, but you can see the updated name in the dashboard once logged in. Now you might be asking yourself how to deploy this web application to the internet without exposing our database key to the public. And this depends on the hosting service you are choosing. For example, if you are using Heroku, you can configure the environment variables via the command line interface tool or the Heroku dashboard. So you might want to check with your hosting service how to upload those secret keys. Okay guys, and that is all for this tutorial. Thanks for watching and see you in the next video.